Greetings. If you think you want to follow Mohammed's religion, you need to think a bunch about the confused ramblings of the Quran. Let's take a look at the night journey. This is supposed to be one of the miracles Mohammed performed. Okay, not performed, but experienced. Well, mentioned in passing as an unquestionable story. What is the story of the night journey and where does it come from? It is a brief mention of an alleged incident where Mohammed flew on some unknown winged animal to the mosque in Jerusalem. It comes from Sura 17:1. Sura 17:1, Glory to Allah who did take his servant for a journey by night from the sacred mosque to the farthest mosque, whose precincts we did bless, in order that we might show him some of our signs, for he is the one who heareth and seeth all things. That's it. All of it. That is the only mention in the Quran of this event. It does not mention Jerusalem, does it? No. But this surah is taught as evidence of Islam's claim to Jerusalem. So let us make a close and thorough examination of this surah. And as we read Surah 17:1 again, I would like you to focus on the pronouns and focus on the voice. Who is speaking? How can we know who is speaking? Glory to Allah. Notice that it begins with glory to. The Allah is an addition by translators. And you can check other translations. They also ascribe this as Muhammad saying glory to Allah. Since these are Muhammad's voice, let's color these words red. Who did take his servant for a journey by night. The phrase his servant must carry the following meanings for the pronouns. His is possessive and can only mean Allah's. But again, this is not spoken in the voice of Allah. Since this is not Allah's voice, it must either be Muhammad's voice or someone else, perhaps Jibril. Let's color these words green. The word servant can only mean Muhammad. Again, this voice is not Allah speaking, so let's color this green as well. For a journey by night. The story of a journey by night was told by Muhammad sometime after the event. It was not the next morning. The story was not told because Muhammad's men came in the very next day and said, "O Prophet, where were you? We looked for you, O Prophet. We needed you but could not find you." Nothing of the sort ever happened. There is no record of Muhammad's men ever detecting the Prophet missing, AWOL, absent without leave. And this is one of those troubling issues that those programmed and brainwashed by Muhammad cannot comprehend to ponder, let alone demand an answer to. There is not one single piece of physical evidence that this is anything but a lie. From the sacred mosque to the farthest mosque. Here is an interesting, little, irrefutable, historical fact for you to know. This surah is the only surah in the whole Quran that Mohammedans dare try to claim mentions Jerusalem. Big deal, I hear you say. Actually, the claim that this surah speaks of the mosque in Jerusalem is kind of a big deal. Because when Muhammad wrote this surah, the mosque in Jerusalem did not exist. Allow that to sink in. When Muhammad wrote this surah, the mosque did not exist in Jerusalem. In fact, during Muhammad's whole lifetime, the mosque did not exist in Jerusalem. This is just another little inconvenient proof that Muhammad lied his head off to the ignorant people he deceived. Claiming to visit some place which did not exist is called a lie. So was Allah lying, or was Muhammad lying? Answer me, O Muslim. Was Muhammad lying, or was Allah lying, to claim Muhammad visited a mosque that did not exist? But I digress. This video is about the incoherency of the fabrication, not that it is a fabrication, as clearly the whole claim of a night journey to a non-existent place is a lie. Back to Surah 17:1. Whose precincts we did bless. We. It is pretty clear Muhammad's con is to portray this we as being Allah. This phrase is suddenly in Allah's voice. He's speaking of himself in the royal we. I just want you to be aware this is Allah's voice. This is Allah speaking, whose precincts we, Allah, did bless. Or do you think Muhammad had the power to bless precincts? In order that we might show him. And here is another we, and it is the same we as before. We, Allah. We, Allah, did bless in order that we, Allah, might show him. Does that make sense so far? Can you follow that? Then we encounter him, referring back to the servant of we. We, Allah, might show him. So clearly at this point, him must mean Muhammad. And clearly we now have Allah seeming to talk in his own voice. We, Allah, might show him Muhammad. But honestly, this is about where Allah gets confused. Some of our signs. We, Allah, did bless in order that we, Allah, might show him, Muhammad, some of our signs. Okay, now for an easy question. Who has the signs? Allah. That's Muhammadism 101. Allah has the signs. So this can only be Allah talking, that we, Allah, might show him, Muhammad, some of our, Allah's, signs. But here comes Allah's confusion that should bake your noodle. In order that we, Allah, might show him, Muhammad, some of our, Allah's, signs, for he is the one who heareth and seeth all things. Remember, Allah is speaking. Allah says, our signs. This surah is now in Allah's voice. Then Allah goes and says, for he, not for me, not for I, not for our, for he. Allah is speaking of someone else. He. And look what Allah says about this other person that Allah calls he. For he is the one who heareth and seeth all things. He who? He Muhammad. If the Quran is to be believed, Allah says Muhammad is all-seeing and all-knowing. Read the surah again and let that sink in. For he Muhammad is the one who heareth and seeth all things. Read it in context and focus on who is speaking and who they are speaking about. Glory to Allah, who did take his, Allah's servant, Muhammad, for a journey by night from the sacred mosque to the farthest mosque, whose precincts we, Allah, did bless, in order that we, Allah, might show him, Muhammad, some of our signs, for he, Muhammad, is the one who heareth and seeth all things. If the Quran is to be believed, Allah says that Muhammad is all-seeing and all-knowing. I can hear your Mohammedan brains about to explode. So let's take a moment and examine what you must say in response. First, you must say, only Allah is all-knowing and all-seeing. Fair enough. Clearly, Islam tries to claim Allah is all-knowing and all-seeing. So you can clearly not accept the consistent, logical, and rational definitions of pronouns I have just documented. But that is a red flag that you must abandon consistent, logical, rational thought in order to defend Muhammad. Regardless, you must say this last phrase is in Muhammad's voice. Even though the thought is a continuation and there is no indication that the voice changes. But those twisted by Quranic thinking have no problem changing voices in their heads, phrase by phrase, to try and make ideas fit. But let's play along and read it one other way, applying a different, consistent set of pronoun definitions. Consistency is the damning problem Islam faces at every turn. Or more specifically, Islam's complete lack of consistency is the damning problem it faces at every turn. Let's try to read Surah 17:1 in Muhammad's voice. Glory to Allah, who did take his Allah's servant, me, for a journey by night from the sacred mosque to the farthest mosque, whose precincts we did bless, in order that we might show him some of our signs, for he, Allah, is the one who heareth and seeth all things. Great. Now a good Muslim can live with the last line. Allah is once again all-knowing and all-seeing. But your dodge has created a problem, O Mohammedan. Now Mohammed is showing Allah Mohammed's signs. That we, I, Mohammed, might show him, Allah, some of our, my Mohammed's, signs. Does Allah need to fly Mohammed somewhere so Mohammed can show Allah signs? You see, O Mohammedan, there is no consistent reading you can apply to make sense of this. The only way out for you is an inconsistent and irrational reading that changes voice from phrase to phrase. But if that is the only way to try and make the Quran make sense, you are only lying to yourself. That is a completely fraudulent way to read any text. So I ask you, O Mohammedan, does the truth matter to you in any way? I'll await your answer in the comments to this video. And I think that covers the incoherency in Surah 17:1. That's it. All of it. That is the only mention in the Quran of this alleged event. And boy did Satan, Allah, get this one confused. Because the author of the Quran, be it Allah or Muhammad, cannot get his act straight. There is no choice but to reject the Quran and Muhammad's religion. The prophets of the Torah and Bible never brought the confused and insane ramblings of the man in the cave. Their message is always consistent and does not change voice from phrase to phrase. The Bible never claims God calls a man the all-knowing and all-seeing. The only rational choice is to reject the Quran and Muhammad's man-made religion. O Mohammedan, does the truth matter to you in any way? Does it matter Muhammad claimed he flew to a place that did not exist? Does it matter someone says Muhammad is all-seeing and all-knowing? Does the truth matter to you in any way? You want to be called Muslim. You want to think you are submitting to the real God. But the evidence says that Mohammed lied about going to a far mosque in some imaginary night journey. At what point, O Mohammedan, do you prove you value truth and admit Mohammed lied? At what point do you decide the truth means more to you than obeying Mohammed? Or is Mohammed really your Allah, your God, your Lord, your Master? Mohammed, the dead storyteller, is who you obey and follow and submit to, nay, worship. Time is short, viewers. Do not wait until the Mahdi is rolled out as evidence of Mohammedism's legitimacy. Seek the truth while you may and reject Mohammed's confused ramblings. This is the only rational choice for you to make if you place any value on truth. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.